Hey everybody, Carl here. Welcome back to Trails in the Sky, the third. We're in the previous episode, we defeated Killika and the Bracers here in the inverted mirror-like version of the Lakeside Laboratory. We can head on back. We're all done. Let's go back, chill in the garden, figure out what we're doing next. Okay. I figured maybe a cutscene or something since they were like, hey, why don't we go back to the garden and chill? But, okay. Oh. It's gradual, but the Lord of Phantasma's power is growing ever greater the more time passes. Please hurry. Yeah. Will do, miss. Firstly, though, just gonna regenerate our way back up. Then I guess I'll just... Oh, right, there's one teleport for each of the floor in the looking glass. So that makes sense, considering just how many different teleport spots there are in this chapter. All right, I'll go find the red one. Let's figure out who we need to bring. Okay, here it is.
The face of the monument is glowing, and words are visible upon its surface. The Lord of Phantasma does decree. Here lies the impregnable fortress. Place your hand on this monument, the Divine Blade's successor among your number.
Great. Don't have a clue what impregnable fortress could be referring to, but I think we all know who we're gonna need to have with us this time.
But...
I suppose there's no point in debating if I am fit to be called his successor. No one else seems to match the description, after all. I'd like to try touching it, if you don't mind.
Yeah, it's Richard! Fortress time with Richard? You had a spot anyways on my team. But that means we can swap out Annalise with someone. Who would that be, though? Well, let's do a little talkie round around the place and see if anybody's eager to go out and kick some butt with us right now. The guy's still fighting? Nope. They've changed.
You guys have changed, man.
What's going on here?
From what I know, Killika went back to Calvert not long before Grandpa left Sice on vacation. She just showed up at our house one day to tell us she was off, and that was that.
Sounds about right.
I swear, Killika's something else. Well, whatever. I guess I'll help out with some of the guild's workload in Sice when I get back. She did seem kind of attached to the place and all.
There's no point in getting all panicky now, not after we've come this far. Whoever we end up facing, we'll find a way to win.
Yeah.
Shira's absolutely right here. The best approach here is to keep calm and take obstacles as they come.
Who do I want with me? Because I'd like to drink from the pool now. So, Annalise is gonna go. I don't love her that much. Sorry. Mueller's fun. But like, combat-wise, he's fun. But story-wise, is he that fun? Do I need another big sword guy? I mean, Joshua. I mean, Estelle. I mean, Joshua, though. Estelle's not great.
Let's move out.
Let's bring Joshua back. Are we going to Impregnable Fortress? Is anyone... Yeah, let's bring Joshua. I'm just gonna bring... Let's not think too much about it. Drink from the pool. Perfect. Then swap out with characters that we have already conversed with in this very area. Perfect. And Olivier is drinking by himself. Let's head out. Some of our gang are a little underleveled, but it's not on me. They could be working out while I'm away. I don't have to babysit them. You know, they can do their own thing. Hey. Why did I have to end up somewhere so weird anyway? What's even gonna happen to us?
She's lost all hope.
I see. Joshua and Chloe just hanging out together, huh?
I tried asking Celeste a few questions regarding the Liber Arc. She doesn't possess most of the real Celeste's memories regarding the city. I can only assume that she was given the bare minimum of information regarding it, and nothing more.
I decided to ask Celeste about this library a short while ago. She says this world is capable of absorbing information spaces into itself. The books we see come from the knowledge accumulated within being drawn out through our thoughts and existence. That was what she told me, at least.
I understood all of that.
It's kind of cool, the Ola Gambler Jack, indeed. But I thought I would have more of the books by now. Still missing some books. I'll look into that. We're still missing a couple of books for the bookworm achievement, where we gotta read all the books in the garden. But there's still some more chapters left, so there's time to get it. Hello, Estelle. But oh, I was like, what is that thing? I could not for the life of me figure out what that thing over there was, but I see it now.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, wait for me.
She really can't sleep anywhere, can't she?
I'm feeling kind of hungry, so I came over here to get something to eat.
No, what are you looking at me like that for? Exercise makes you hungry. It's a fact of life.
I'd heard Kiseki was able to make her way through one of the Shadow Towers alone, so she is clearly a force to be reckoned with. I wish I'd been able to meet her while she was still in the Burl, to be honest.
The Lord of Phantasm appears to have some rather capable warriors under his commands. If that's the strength of the Second Guardian, I dread to think how powerful the rest will be. It's gonna be quite the challenge.
So you fought Kiseki, huh? She's a nasty fight, isn't she? If you let her fight with her chakram, she's even stronger than Walter. If she doesn't inherit a Taito style, she's gonna have trouble finding a husband for herself.
Moving on down to the girls. Oh!
I was reluctant to comment at first, but now I feel obliged to do so. Do not find such remarks a little imprudent.
Imprudent?
It's clear from all they've done so far that the Lord of Phantasma is our enemy. Furthermore, while the guardians we are fighting may not be the individuals themselves, their personalities are still being violated. In light of that, I hardly find it appropriate to be talking about all of this like it's some sort of game orchestrated for your entertainment.
Reese? What's got you so mad all of a sudden?
I'm not. However, I was under the distinct impression that we were all in agreement on one thing. The Lord of Phantasma was our enemy. So I will not stand by and listen to them being, of all things, praised.
Really now? Come to think of it, every time we've encountered them, they always made a point of taunting you and Kevin, haven't they? That wouldn't have anything to do with why you're angry, would it? Oh, I bet it does. The Lord of Phantasma seems to have a peculiar fascination with Kevin, and yet you just can't work out why. That's why you're getting so worked up, isn't it?
This isn't a game, Ren. You might be a genius, but that doesn't mean everything in life will go the way you want it to, and to assume otherwise is sheer arrogance.
Who would interject in this?
Okay, that's enough.
Okay, that's enough. Let's stop this before it gets nasty.
Ren, bringing up things that clearly bother people and teasing them with them isn't a very nice thing to do.
As for you, Reese, she might be smarter than other girls her age. It doesn't change the fact that Ren is still an ordinary 12-year-old girl. Excuse me?
I'm not sure I understand what you mean.
Well, let me put it this way. She's smart and she's strong. We both know that. But do those two things really make her that much different from other girls her age? Or make it so that she can't act like they do? I think you'd find plenty of 12-year-olds out there who are a little selfish and cheeky, or like to cause trouble. That's pretty normal. Plus, she's got tons of good points too, like how she's always considerate towards others when the situation calls for it. See, she's just like your average girl who goes to Sunday school, right? Just a little brighter, and a little stronger. You think so? It just doesn't seem fair to me to hold her to a totally different standard than everyone else her age because you see her as somehow different. That's not to say don't tell her off if she's been bad, because you do that to kids too. It's more you're being unusually hard on her.
I suppose you may be right. You have my apologies, Ren.
Really? I wasn't expecting an apology from you. Although, your face says you've still got a lot you want to say to me.
Naturally. After all, admonishing unreasonable children is the duty of their elders, however special or not special they may be.
Yep, like I said, I'm not gonna disagree on that point. As long as we're all here, we're basically your guardians and stuff. Oh, please. You can say what you like. But by the way, Estelle, you said I was just like your average girl who goes to Sunday school, right?
Sure did. Am I wrong?
You can think whatever you like about me. I don't care. I do want to make one correction. I wouldn't be attending school as a student. I'd be teaching there. I got 3 doctorates after all.
You what?
What?
One's in chemistry, one's in mathematics, and the 3rd is in information theory. I even publish regular papers in those fields. I do it through someone else because I don't want the hassle of someone finding out who I am, though. Right.
Disciplining her appears as if it will be an even more difficult task than I'd anticipated.
What a great optional scene! By the way, Ren has 3 doctorates.
Don't go underestimating me if you wouldn't mind. And don't forget, you got no chance of getting out of this world unless I'm with you to help.
I'll take you with me, just calm down.
There are some challenging looking books on the bookshelf.
100 Days War! Bam, 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 bam. And now my favorite book series, Ruon Economics! Volume 1. Volume 2. Volume 3. Septium Optic Annals.
Nice. So that should be another 5 books added to the total book count for Bookworm. Has it been tracked already? It has not been tracked already. So that means we're sitting at 46. So we're missing 6 more books other than these ones. Okay. But now, where did Rhys disappear off to? Now that she's done lecturing the infant. Probably over here. It was kind of sparse over here. She's not here? I haven't really seen her that much over in the leftmost part here. She's not up here. Well, let's go see if we can find her. Have a little chat. Oh, there. I was about to say Olivier probably scared her off, but here she is.
Estelle really is too soft for her own good.
Well, it's just part of who she is. It just is. I think she's radiant and wonderful. And on that note, let's get these guys off my party. We're taking with us Joshua, Ren, and Richard. Probably one of my favorite team setups. And then I'm getting them ready for battle, and we're gonna head out. And are you that many levels behind Joshua? No, Joshua's good. He's good, man. I'll equip them all for battle. Okay, Joshua's gotten a bit of an upgrade too. He's basically gotten all the stuff that Annalise had, and he's gotten a bit of an upgrade with his slots as well. He's got that death and move and a couple of other fun things. So he's ready to go. I'm ready to go, and we are going. Now, we know the next one is going to be that impregnable fortress with our dude Richard, but Moon Doors, officially complete. Very cool. Star Doors, we have found something new. We found the girl who plays with her dolls. We have a Ren Door, and we have just a Trial Door. 2 Star Doors and Sun Door. We actually have the next arena. That's right. Okay. I think what we're going to do, let's check out the Star Doors. I don't think they're super long Star Doors, so it should be okay. And then we can see what we want to do after that, if we want to take on the arena. But I think this is just going to be a door day. Gonna do a door dash.
Bring to me the girl who plays with a giant doll. However, inside a trial awaits her. Should this fail to deter you, open the door and step inside.
We're going. I think she got this. Her alone or all of us?
Star Chamber.
They always get the little girls to fight by themselves.
Overcome the trial before you, then I shall grant you a memory fragment and my blessing.
Okay, more of these fun boys. Star Guardian heals those who attack it when its HP starts to get low. Status altering ray on foes, patrol archaism. Alright. Could I just renegade all of these boys? Not quite, they're not in range for that. I think I'm just gonna start with the Calamitous Blast here. Hope they can't cancel my arts. Gorgon Laser? That's okay, I can deal with the Gorgon Laser. Poison? Just never hurt a girl. Oh. Still good, we're still good, we're still good. Impede is the only thing that can really take me out here. Okay. Calamitous Blast right here. Oh, that worked out much better than I thought it would. Boom, boom, boom. And now, this guy is not weak to anything in particular, so just a strong dark matter. Get a heal turn right here. And good night. Okay, trial in quotation marks.
Later, corpses.
Oh, man, she rules. Insulating tape, reviving ball, celestial bomb.
You have overcome the trial. Thus, I shall grant you a memory fragment and my blessing.
Loading. Complete.
Potter Modder.
The design docs?
Gordias-Class Tactical Archaism Development Plan. Author, 13 Factories. Codename, Potter Modder. Plan Overview. We intend to develop a cutting-edge archaism that inherits the DNA of the rest of the Gordias series while containing a more advanced control system. It will retain the same tactical effectiveness that was a primary development goal in previous models, while allowing for more flexible and precise strategic usage as well. Effective radius. The archaism is intended to be accessible across the whole continent. Powerful main and sub-engines should allow it to operate for several years without resupplying. Autonomous combat ability. The use of the Mars Integrated Orbital Arithmetic Logic Unit will allow for advanced autonomous combat and effective identifying of targets. In addition, the Archaism's control system will make use of the operator's nervous system, allowing for reflexive, instinctive movements in combat. The operator will communicate with the Archaism without being in physical contact with it. This will require a compatible candidate to be found and chosen. Dimensions. Whoa! Height weights. Overall height, 15.5 arch. Unit weights, 55 torum. 68 torum when fully armed. Armaments. The Archaism's primary weaponry will be its orbital energy cannons, but it will have other kinds of orbital weaponry and even several gunpowder-powered weapons as backup. It will also have a revival system, which will use an orbment to generate healing energy to heal or revive its operator in times of danger. Armor material. The armor plating will be made using curdaligan alloy. Curdaligan is the most fitting material to use, given that it is the most capable we have access to in all regards. For dating regarding strength, see files on Gospel Plan. Current progress. New engines. Development is proceeding smoothly, in line with the plans drawn up by Professor Novartis. Tests have also confirmed that they are already capable of providing power to the actuators. However, the professor has raised concerns about the low responsiveness of the flight engine. This is especially true for the anti-gravity generator. He concluded that the engine, as it stands, cannot be put into actual use. The possibility of using boosters to provide additional propulsion is under consideration.
Actuators.
Development of the actuators is experiencing significant difficulty, as it isn't possible to simply use the same ones as the other archaisms. The increased size of the main weaponry means the archaisms' weight during combat is significant, and as a result, problems have been occurring in durability tests, especially with the leg joints. It may be possible to make improvements in this area by using precise control so the weight burden is spread evenly rather than focused on one point. Main armaments. The orbital energy cannons that will serve as its primary armaments have been successfully tested. However, by order of Professor Novartis, the possibility of them becoming twin mounts, is being analyzed, so they have yet to be equipped. The new orbital engines are expected to be able to provide enough energy to compensate for the necessary increase in output. Control system. Experiments regarding the control system are currently ongoing. For the results of the experiments that have been carried out so far, see a separate entry. Experiment results.
Whoa! This is how you do one of these like PowerPoint ones. This is so much more interesting than the Epstein Foundation one. Just like the layout of the UI, bopping music, some really cool images.
Tests of the control system continue to be performed. However, none of the test subjects have been able to realize the expected level of precision we are aiming for. The results of the main test conducted by Professor Novartis and his team can be viewed above. Test results. Test subject, subject A1, abnormality during phase 2, comatose. Test subject, subject B3, abnormality during phase 3, cardiac arrest. Test subject, subject C1, abnormality during phase 1, insanity. Test subject, subject D7, abnormality during phase 2, comatose. Test subject, subject E3, abnormality during phase 2, cardiac arrest. Test subject, subject F2, abnormality during phase 2, comatose. Test subject, subject G4, abnormality during phase 3, comatose. Test subject, subject H1, abnormality during phase 2, comatose. Test subject, subject 16, I6. How can you tell the difference, Martina? Abnormality during phase 4, mental breakdown. As can be seen, all of the test subjects failed to adapt to the control system. Nonetheless, the Society continues to supply test subjects, and we intend to keep performing further experiments. Future developments. We have received word from the Society that development is to be temporarily frozen. Their reasoning is that the stability of the control system is in question. From now on, only test subjects carefully chosen by the Society will be taking part in connection tests.
Such as our little rat.
Test subjects. Subject R3. Successfully completed all 4 testing phases. Note, the subject did experience a small degree of flashbacks. Test subject, subject R3. Succeeded in communicating with Pottermater. Ascertaining the Society's intentions in regards to resuming development. Subject R3 has succeeded in operating Pottermater. Ascertaining the Society's intentions in regards to resuming development. Gordias-Class Experiment Reports.
10,000 Mira! That was cool! Short and sweet, didn't stay too long. Cool visuals to go with a lot of, you know, geeky information. Just, yeah, I like that. That was a good info door. Hell yeah! Moving on! What was the next Star Door that we had? We have Star Door 11, okay. No hint as to what this one is, just that it's a trial. I ain't scared.
Those who seek to enter this door must first overcome a trial. Should this fail to deter you, open the door and step inside. Let's go!
Star Chamber.
Overcome the trial before you, then I shall grant you a memory fragment and my blessing.
Oh, they brought some bots for this. Star Guardian, Mirror Vanguard, oh, reflects arts used on it. Okay, well,
Sparrowloa.
We're just gonna go all out. Actually,
the best tactic is to start with Mr. Richard. Blah, 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 because he's gonna regenerate CP on every turn. Oh damn. Alright, let's go. You know what time it is. Sakura. Morning. Moon! Just like that. I mean, why not go all out? Oh! Good night. Deuce. Ren, you want the honor. Here I come. Why take the long route? Oh, he gets one turn, huh? World Shaker. Yow. Okay, I see. He's gonna seal us while they were really, you know, immune to arts. That's mean. That's mean, mister. And there he goes.
Richard learned True Luminous Divider.
And a couple of Sephiroth right there. I think 300's max for what we can get in a category.
You have overcome the trial. Thus, I shall grant you a memory fragment and my blessing. An investigative report on Phantom Thief B, his crimes, his history, and his true identity. Imperial Chronicle Investigative Team. Whoa. That's dope. Phantom Thief B has had quite a lengthy and productive career in thievery in the Empire, as the amount of records we have been able to find on his crimes proves beyond a doubt. From numerous paintings held in the Imperial Art Gallery, to a septium crystal held in the Empire's customs warehouse, to even a cutting-edge tank held in an Imperial Army research facility. Nothing is truly safe when he desires to steal it. His conquests aren't limited to inanimate objects. He has been guilty of pretending to be a military officer and eloping with the wife of a marquis on one reported occasion. Yet, and this is perhaps the most baffling part, there is no concrete evidence to suggest he has profited from his exploits. Rather, the objects stolen usually end up in places so bizarre, their owners are liable to faint upon hearing about them. In other cases, they are transformed into mira, which is then rained down from the sky in areas largely inhabited by those less fortunate. Hearing this, one might be led to think him a vigilante thief who takes from the rich and giving to the poor. But make no mistake, the truth is not so simple. The wife of the Marquis discussed earlier is a fine example of that. As of this writing, it has been a little over half a year since the elopement took place. Since then, she has remained unaccounted for. Many of the items stolen by him may return to the public eye in some fashion, but not all. Between his eccentric techniques and bizarre behavior regarding the objects he steals, it might appear as though his thefts are purely whims and nothing else. Upon studying the overall picture and reviewing the objects, and indeed people, in play, you begin to see that they all have one specific thing in common. Take the artwork stolen from the Imperial Art Gallery, for example. Each of them were works of pure genius, painted by a master of their craft. But they gained a reputation for being too complex for the target audience of such works, the nobility, and were shamefully stored away instead of placed on display. Similar could be said of the Septium Crystal. Known for its unparalleled beauty, after being seized by customs, it was sealed away in the warehouse and doomed never to be admired by human eyes again. The tank, again, is one more example, with its promising development cut short. Rather than be put to good use, it was left collecting dust. As an aside, the case of the Marquis's wife does contain some striking similarities. Despite marrying her, he devoted most of his attention to his concubines and barely spared a thought for her. In conclusion, we can see now that the underlying motive for his actions is finding objects of beauty that have been abandoned by the world and freeing them from their foolish owners. No matter how the world may see his crimes, his motive is clear. The truth of that is evident in the cards he leaves before committing his crimes. This is the so-called Liberation of Beauty mentioned upon each of them. Phantom Thief B steals not for money, but for an ideal he believes in. And it is in this fact, we believe, are clues to his true identity. A number of valid theories have come about on the face behind our famed thief. Unfortunately, they are all as lacking in conclusive proof as they are numerous, and so it is impossible to say whether any of them are actually correct. To complicate matters further, we now even have deranged individuals coming forward pretending to be him and allowing themselves to be captured by law enforcement. That is not to say, however, that none of the theories circulating are at all plausible. Here we will introduce three such theories which have developed significant followings and may not turn out to be too far from the truth. Theory 1. Amorous con artist X. X's personal history. X is known for his exceptional skills as a con artist, having faked his own identity in order to engage in romantic relationships with many noble women. He was as handsome as he was capable, and he was exceptionally proud in nature as well. Born to a poor family in the temperate south, he became used to stealing in order to make ends meet from a young age. According to testimony from a companion of his at the time, he was never once caught for such thefts. The reason X converted from being a common thief to a con artist is believed to have stemmed from falling in love with a noblewoman of much higher social standing than he. The rule of the aristocracy was absolute in the country he called home, and blessed romances between those of different classes unthinkable. With that in mind, he resolved to create a false identity in order to make his dream possible. Following his first rousing success, he came to do the same on a myriad of other occasions, indulging in one forbidden affair after another. It was a mere 10 years ago that he was arrested on suspicion of identity fraud, but he performed a miraculous escape from prison. Ever since then, his whereabouts have remained unknown. Thoughts. Both X's peerless skills as a thief and his interest in forbidden romances with noble women sound remarkably like what we know of Phantom Thief B. Also worth noting is that despite using his abilities of deception to court those of vast wealth, he displayed virtually no interest in their fortunes. That is to say, he gained no financial benefit from his actions whatsoever. Instead, he simply lamented that he was unable to indulge in them because of something as trivial as his social class. We conclude that this attitude bears a striking resemblance to the thief's own views on beauty. Theory 2. Tragic Artist Y. Y's personal history. Y was an artist with a rather tragic past. Born to a middle-class family in the north, he was hired by an influential aristocrat to be their personal artist, producing many a stunning piece of work. However, it was later discovered that wasn't all he produced. On the contrary, he was also responsible for a number of counterfeit pieces. The one who hired him sought to profit through ill means thanks to his work, and so he created such counterfeits under the noble's instructions. One day, however, Y suddenly left the noble's service. The reason remains unknown. This is where his tragedy begins. Immediately after leaving his client behind, Y received a terrible piece of news. His lover, the daughter of a respected family, had been killed in a traffic accident. While there is no evidence to prove as much, it is rumored that the noble may have had a hand in her death. Y was only spotted once more at his lover's grave, before forever disappearing from the public eye. To those who knew his story, he became known as the truly tragic artist. Several years later, the noble was murdered. Thoughts. The story of Y still has several unsolved mysteries surrounding it, and has invited much speculation, both of which have likely led to the theory that he and Phantom Thief B are one and the same. Those aren't the only reasons, naturally.
Phantom Thief B has been known, at times, to try and dispose of counterfeits, believing them to be false beauty. This has led some to believe that Phantom Thief B may be attempting to rid the world of counterfeits that he himself created, lending further credibility to this as the discovery that the forgeries disposed of by Phantom Thief B were indeed the works of Y. Theory 3. Skilled Martial Artist Z. Z's personal history. The story of Z is significantly different from the other two potential identities we have proposed here, making this an unusual, but still plausible, possibility. Z was born in the Far East as the son of a famed military family. He was an attractive, delicately built young man, but he was far more skilled at martial arts than his frame would have suggested, being blessed with great natural talent. He is also said to possess a keen, sharp mind, and there was a mild air of arrogance about him, too. Z was indeed blessed in nearly every way. He came from an important family, he had skill, he had looks. And as a result, he came to feel bored with the world around him. He hardly kept such thoughts to himself. In fact, he often voiced his complaints to anyone within earshot. These complaints persisted until one day, he simply disappeared, telling no one where he was going, and leaving nothing to suggest his next destination. Thoughts. Much of this theory is based on the idea of geniuses being eccentric by nature. There are some who say that the fighting style of Z had some resemblance to the peculiar skills used by Phantom Thief B. But in terms of credibility, this theory is barely a cut above many other similarly unusual suggestions. Still, the idea that the man beneath the mask is one from the East is certainly an interesting and exciting one, leading many to wish it were true, even if they find themselves doubting it actually is. That brings us to the end of outlining three very different theories. Could X, Y, or Z be the true identity of our famed Phantom Thief? Or is the truth perhaps something else entirely? The only way we will know for sure is to hear the truth from the man himself. Of course, whether we can trust anything he says is a discussion for another time. Postscript. After this article was first published, we received a card believed to be from Phantom Thief B himself at our office. The contents of the card are as follows. The truth of my identity is already within your grasp. My number reveals all. Judging by this, it is believed that one of the three theories proposed is the true identity of Phantom Thief B. That said, uncovering the meaning behind his words has proven to be a trying task. Will one valued reader be able to step forward and solve what we cannot? Only time will tell. Side story, Phantom Thief B report finished. Phantom Thief's cape? 10,000 Mira? Cool. That was neat. A little deep dive in the backstory of Phantom Thief B. What is this cape right here? Let me see it. Phantom Thief's cape. Agility plus 20, move plus 3, drop rate up, increases odds of foes dropping items. That's fun. Also, that move 3 is... it's very fun. I like that. Can I put that on somebody? I want to put that on somebody. Happiness stone. Maybe I'll put it on Kevin. He has obtained Sepeth, which has been pretty fun, but let's check out that Tiankla plus that we've gotten too, by the way. Various stats up, prevents freeze petrify. Oh, dude, sweet. That's a fun one. But let's put on the Phantom Thief's cape. Yeah. Fun, fun, fun. Okay. Those are almost all the doors taken care of, but if we go to the sun doors, we still have the... this is the arena one. We got a new invitation. The last time we did the arena on normal, was it? Or was it easy? Or is it normal, hard, and then nightmare, I think. We got the next invitation. The path has already been opened. Open the door and step inside. Proof of your right to challenge the ordeals inside in hand. Open the door. I mean, we could. Do we have the CP for that? We don't really have the CP for that. I kind of used it all on the... I'm good.
I see. That's my crutch. I can make do. Watch me defeat this.
Ah, good day. It's nice to see you. So, would you like to participate again? Oh, is that an invitation I see? Could I trouble you to hand it over?
The tournament invitation was carefully inspected.
Thank you. You may now challenge the hard arena whenever you see fit. Well, what would you like to do now?
Participate in the tournament?
Let's go. Splendid! Well then, if you don't mind following me.
Ah, yes. Back at it again.
Feel the sting of the Swordmaster's blade.
Start it up. Start it up right here. Okay. Nice start right here. I'm trying to think what the... We might be healed between rounds. I think we're healed between rounds. Maybe EP2? I don't quite remember.
It is now the moment you've all been waiting for. Tonight, four new warriors will be stepping up to the plate and challenging the hard arena. So let's get right to introducing our fierce fighters, shall we? In the blue corner, we're led by Father Kevin Graham of the Septian Church's Grawlsritter. Standing against him in the red corner, we have the mysterious Team Black Jaegers. Let the first round begin! Step on up and ready your weapons! Ready? Fight!
Let's do it. Alright, Kev. We have Black Jaegers, Steel Cougars, nothing we haven't faced before. Ooh, this could be fun. If we pop like a Silverthorn to get some of them confused. I still think just Calamitous Blast is a good way to start us off. Lower their ADF. Richard, he just needs a couple of turns here to get some of his stuff up. I'm just going to go in and hit the kitty cat right here, I think. Joshua, too. I'm just going to send into the... I'm going to send him up into the fray right here. Just push him out, which probably wasn't the best. But I wanted him in here so he can attract some attention to himself. Oh! Stepped out of it either way. Shoot them full of bullets. Do they have some sort of impede bullets? Okay. Come on, step inside the big circle on the ground. Nothing bad will happen. Oh no, Joshua can't use arcs. What am I gonna do? Everybody stepped out of it. Okay, he stayed in though. That's something. Calamitous Blast right here. Coming in. Ooh. Richard's S-Craft isn't the best here since it's single target, and none of these guys are really the main focus, but let's see what we can do with it. They resist confuse. That's annoying, but it's okay. I think we're just going to Death Scream, and then Richard, you're just going to do your other things here, such as a True Luminous Wheel, I think. Yes, right here. Yeah. Nice. And then this ought to get some of them. Yeah. One of them at least. They do have big health pools. Drop this right here. Oh. Nice. They're staying up here to fight with Joshua. I like that. Just going to keep Joshua up here. And you, Mr. True Luminous Wheel. Can we do something fun with that? Not really. I'm just going to go for a simple... I'm going to go for this man over here. Just finish him off. There we go. Steel Cougar coming in. What you want? Bind Cry. Okay, he also sealed. Terra Bomb. Oh, he's going to heal the doggy. That's kind of wholesome. Anyways, get Silver Thorns. Cool. Alright, dude, Richard is ready to go. But I think we just, Death Scream. Shazam! Just like that. That's a triple kill.
not much Richard can do here. He's just gonna go over and, I don't know, pet the tiger. You though, Joshua. Pow. You can finish him off. Get him, Kevin. Yeah! Nice warm-up rounds.
Not bad.
Not bad at all.
The match is decided. The winner is Father Graham's team.
Okay, whatever could be next. Okay, what? Guys, did you have to bring all the archaisms to the 13 factories?
Let's keep up this momentum. First, allow me to introduce who will be fighting in the second round. In the blue corner, we're led by Father Kevin Graham of the Septian Church's Grossritter. Standing against him in the red corner, we have the 13 factories manufactured team, Rheingold. Step on up and ready your weapons. Ready, fight!
Okay, let's check these guys out. Armor is exceptionally tough. There's also something in the middle here. Gold Lior. Unleash its full power when HP is low. Well, still gonna attack you, mate. Calamitous Blast going in. We have... Do we just, like, throw out some True Luminous Wheels? Just use... I think that's what I'm gonna use Richard's CP for. Just some area of effect attacks right here. Yeah, rather than just going for one. Maybe. Dude, he's already back to 200. That's kind of crazy. Maybe Death Scream is best, because these guys don't have any particular weaknesses or affinities. And Confuse, I'm not even going to try Confuse on a robot. I've learned some things. I could Evil Eye. Evil Eye is kind of hyped due to the attack delay. So, please. They resist. Well, that gave me just enough for a true Phantom Rage. That's some damage. Ah, screw it. Screw it, why not? Since they're all clumped up so well.
Ready or not, here I come.
I don't know how much blood are gonna come out of these, but we'll see. Nice, they actually have like a different visual. I'm just gonna pop Richard. There's no point not popping him on this strength up turn. Okay, Gold Lior. Take care of this guy. Because he's gonna have 200 CP by the time it's his turn again. I mean, at least 100 CP. You love to see it. Okay, what do they got? They're coming in. They're moving on up. Slam Duncan. Joshua's got moved down. That's okay. Analyzing combat data. That's weird. Don't do that. Don't do that to Ren. Her combat data is private. Bullet Barrage. I mean, they're just gonna see your ATS stat and be like, oh, we're out of here. Oh, Phantom Rage. Thank you. Dude, and Joshua gets half of his CP bar filled up by doing Phantom Raid on all of these boys. It's kind of insane. Oh, you're in for it now. Spear of Loa. Fire away. Ah, there we go. So, oh, dude, that's dangerous. Okay. There we go. Now we can take it a bit easier, methinks. Just finish off these guys, try to regenerate a bit of our craft points for the next rounds. And fire off right there. Yeah, we're just gonna take it easy now. Our health and EP don't matter. So just gonna chill. Smoke missiles coming in, blinding Ren. Bullet barrage on all of the team, thank you. As long as Joshua doesn't die here. Perfect. Everything is under control, don't worry about it. What's the range of Richard? Is it... It's good enough to actually get to him. He just zooms across the field, does a slash, takes an explosion to the face. Yeah. That was easy. Ninja Tobby? Dude, I'll take that.
The match is decided. The winner is Father Graham's team. Woo! You go.
All right, third round. The moment is upon us at last. It is time for the final round to begin. Will our challengers emerge victorious one last time? You won't have to wait long to find out. Well, allow me to introduce our final teams. What? In the blue corner, we're led by Father Kim and Graham with the Septian Church's Gross Ritter. Standing against him in the red corner, we have what may be an ancient dragon, Team Baby Dragon. Step on up and ready your weapons. Ready? Fight!
Hey, it's me, Baby Dragon. I'm back. Good to see you guys. Just came to visit you in the arena.
Tiny Ragnard, a young dragon that resembles Ragnard. Attacks with tackles and to its seahorse demon. Well. I don't quite know what to say here, but I'm going to try. Oh, dude, if I could drop a Silverthorn right here, that would be sick. All right, what about you, Mr. Sakura Morning Moon Man? I think... Yeah, let's just Sakura Morning Moon. This poor baby dragon. Oh. Richard is just so dangerous. If he'd only used this during the boss battle in FC, it would not have stood a chance. That's a strong dragon, though. Tanky boy. I guess he's a baby ancient dragon after all. Oh, this would be perfect. I can also suck them all. I'm gonna try and some of them are probably gonna move up a bit. That's okay. I want to suck them to the back and then lower their move a bit. Yeah, this is gonna be good. Ren's sleeping on the job. Honestly, girl. I thought you were past the nap time stage of life. Just like that. All right, Ragnard. No, he flew out. He blinded us all? Oh, no. Don't. Okay. I might be blind. Joshua doesn't need his eyes to see the enemy. Phantom! Oh, man, they're strong. They're actually really strong, okay? However, this suction should help. Oh, this is bad. Okay, it's actually bad. It's actually getting bad. I did not come prepared for... Okay. Sakura Morning Moon. Just like that. Monstrous bubble. Oh! We're awake. Silver Thorn. At least, please confuse some of them, at least. Don't tell me though. Everybody resist confused. What's the point of that status effect if none of the enemies can... Alright, I wanted to Dark Matter EX right here. Rather than the whole big blast, because I want to see if I can pull them all back, lower some move, because it looks like they need to be close to do something, and then thanks to that, now that they're all grouped up, dude, that's kind of perfect. We do the suction into Arenada. Let's go. Got you. Ooh. Very good. Now then, mister. This boy's right here. Are they all gonna go for Richard next? What would be the best thing to do here? It's my whole team. Dude, I have some stuff like... Maybe it's worth using some, Yeah. Let's throw out a sludgy cookie. Why not? Seems like a good opportunity.
Eat this!
Perfect. And then Sakura Morning Moon. Now we got him. One more hit on Joshua, please. You're playing into my hand. I mean, Joshua's about to die, but hopefully this Phantom Raid right here is gonna do the trick. Oh, and there we go. Okay, that almost turned around in their favor, but not quite. Oh.
Not done yet.
Nice. Celestial Bomb, Fish Filet, Curative Horn.
The match is decided. The winner is Father Graham's team. They've done it. Father Graham's team has conquered the hard arena. Poor baby Ragnard.
Congratulations to all of you on your victory. That really was quite the show of skill. Your matches were a joy to watch. These are but a small token of my appreciation for putting on such a fine show.
Spiritual. 10,000 Mira.
You've now earned the right to challenge the Nightmare Arena. You will still need to find an invitation in order to do so, however. Should you find one, please do come back here.
Will do, sir. The arena. It is now possible to take on the Nightmare Arena. Entering the door with the required item will allow you to challenge it. Let's check out what we just got. Spiritual. I'd guess it's the opposite of physical. Receive less magic damage, but more physical damage. Not super keen on that at the moment. It's very specific. It requires planning. Okay. That should be everything so far, other than just that last arena that we still have to find. Which means that we should technically be ready to jump to the scenic route, and we have the required man in the party right here. So without further ado, let's just go strolling looking for this place. I think I remember. I think we need to get to it's to the south here. Just gotta follow the roads. I was looking where I was going even. It's not like I wasn't. Alright, well, it's just how we do this. Attack here. Calamitous Blast. Hold on. And nice. Those guys can actually drop kitty stuff, so it is worth stopping by. Ah, here it is. Ready to go in with Richard for whatever awaits, but I think this is a perfect time for us to end off and continue in the next one. Everybody, thank you so much for watching. I've been your host, Carl, and this has been Trails to Completion.